John 4, Jesus said, "The man old in days will not hesitate to ask a small child 7 days old about the place of life, and he will live. For many who are first will become last, and they will become one and the same." Interpretation of, "The man old in days will not hesitate to ask a small child 7 days old about the place of life, and he will live." The man always represents the spiritual self, the I, in I am. The man old in days refers to the spiritual self, which pre-existed its new mind and physical body. The seven-day-old child refers to the spiritual self, on its seventh day of its new life journey. At this point in time, the spiritual self has no problem realizing that it is the life, and because of this, it lives, for there is no ignorance of itself in its mind. It was said in Matthew chapter 18 verse 3, "Verily I say unto you, except ye be converted, and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven." Interpretation of, "For many who are first will become last, and they will become one and the same." There is the soul, the self and mind, and there is the physical body. The soul existed before the physical body and so was first. When the self forgets its true nature as a spiritual being, it comes to believe that it is the physical body, and thereby self-realization is lost. It is then that the two become one, because the self sees no difference between itself and the physical body. Note, the self, the mind and the body are three separate and distinct things. The first two are of the spiritual, and the third is of the world.
There was once a boy who walked on his hands. This caused him to see things differently from other people. He was able to see under things, things that were close to the earth, small things, intimately. But being different from other children, he knew that there was more than one way to look at things. He didn't mind at all being different. His life was one adventure after the other. He had a wonderful time examining things, finding out how they were made and how they worked. And though many people who crossed his path were harassed and frowning, from his point of view, they appeared to be smiling, and this made him very happy. But he made people uncomfortable. They thought it was somehow wrong that the boy should not see things their way, the right way. They decided that he should be straightened out. They held a town meeting to determine what could be done. They called in experts. The doctor said, "A rare case of deficiency of hypertension and heart palpitation. Lungs peculiarly unclouded, digestive system, non-acid. It's obvious this young man is deprived of the manifold tastes, colors, shapes, and effects of the assorted patent medicines available and so widely enjoyed by our population." The psychiatrist said, "A strange instance of psychic equilibrium or well-being, highly unrealistic to say the least. An absence of Oedipal manifestations and paranoid behavior. Obviously, his hate instincts have been suppressed." The sociologist said, "A sad lack of competitive drive, incidents of concern for others, naive trust in human nature, inconceivable passivity toward the war." His teacher said, "He's always been unusual. He has to paint grass pink and water purple. He refuses to call a fact a fact. Oh, he's not a bad boy, but with all his questions, why this, why that, who knows how he'll wind up?" His parents said, "We just don't know how this happened to us. What sort of profession will he ever have? Isn't there some way to overcome this dreadful condition?" So the boy was put under therapeutic treatment, given injections, simultaneous hot baths and cold showers, spun centrifugally clockwise, then counterclockwise, put in traction, lobotomy, frontal and backward, given brainwashing 3 times a day, saturated with TV commercials and red and blue radiation. The treatment went on for a prolonged period. Finally, the boy stood up, for the first time, on his feet. What he saw frightened him, because he found that the opposite view of love was hate, beauty was ugliness, individuality was conformity, plenty was poverty, understanding was prejudice, cooperation was competition, depth was superficiality, concern was indifference, truth was lies, joy was despair, and peace was war. He went into a spin and landed on his hands. "This is impossible," said the townspeople. "We're back where we started from. He must be made to see right from wrong." But the boy, in spite of all the back to health conditioning, was adamant. He said, "If you want me to stand on my feet, you will have to make some big changes first."
You turn me inside out and round and round.
Ogean 6, his disciples questioned him and said to him, "Do you want us to fast? How shall we pray? Shall we give alms? What diet shall we observe?" Jesus said, "Do not tell lies, and do not do what you hate, for all things are plain in the sight of heaven. For nothing hidden will not become manifest, and nothing covered will remain without being uncovered." Interpretation of, do not tell lies. If you tell lies you may deceive others, but you cannot hide the lies from yourself, and then knowing that you have lied, you will have put on the garments of self-condemnation and shame. It is better to die in truth than live in the denial of it. Interpretation of, and do not do what you hate. You must do what is in your heart. To do otherwise is to do what you hate, and to make yourself a deceiver. There is no profit for the soul in doing things that are absent of sincerity. If you do what you hate, then you will become the servant of what you hate, and what you hate will become your master. Interpretation of, for all things are plain in the sight of heaven. For nothing hidden will not become manifest, and nothing covered will remain without being uncovered. In the kingdom of heaven the mind is an open book. This gospel of the kingdom has not been given to condemn those who have sinned, but rather it is given to prepare those who know they have sinned, and wish to turn from sin, and enter the kingdom of heaven. It is for these sinners that Christ came. Those who sin and do not realize that they have sinned, the spiritually blind and dead, remain in their innocence, for they know not what they do. Logian 7, Jesus said, "Blessed is the lion which becomes man when consumed by man, and cursed is the man whom the lion consumes, and the lion becomes man." Interpretation, a person may have two self-identities, two egos, one as a spiritual being, and the other as a physical being. The two self-identities cause the mind to be divided, which results in a struggle between the two, until one is consumed and the other becomes the master, resulting in an undivided mind. Either one of these self-identities may eventually have complete domination. The lion represents the self-image of being a physical body. The man represents the true image of being a spiritual being. Blessed is the self who knows his true identity as a spiritual being, and consumes the false identity of being a physical being. Cursed is the self who believes that he is no more than a physical being, and consumes his true identity as a spiritual being.
Discipline is truly an action of looking back at ourselves. As one visually and mentally sees their actions, one can realize with real eyes what they are or are not doing to themselves, and thus also to their internal and external environment. However, when this is not done, all manner of sorrow and pain is consistently inevitable. This is because that which is ignored always eventually rises to the surface, bringing with it the cycle of the very problems which continuously manifest in whatever form is most convenient to the undisciplined pupil. For example, if there is a contention with food, the mind's eye will decide to use food to cover the issue, which only encircles the problem back onto itself, which inherently compounds it, making it ever harder to deal with. It would be the same with relationship issues. When a couple is fighting or having other deep-seated issues, either one or both individuals typically seek out another external relationship to try and cover their difficulties, which again encircles the problem, compounds it, and simply adds more pain and hardship. The logic behind this method is that to the mind, it is easier to externalize everything and put the blame of the situation upon outside factors, instead of turning the mind's eye inwards to see the root and realize with real eyes that the only problem is a self problem. If one were to accomplish this discipline, there would be a transition from externalization to internalization, and the process of discipline could commence from the very roots of the thing. Otherwise, one is in a constant condition of apophasis, the rhetoric of bringing up an issue by denying that very issue, or to mention something by saying that it will not be mentioned. This is what the mind is doing in its external habits of undisciplined action. I know I have a problem, but I'm not going to deal with the problem. By doing this, the blind disciple asserts their justified reasoning of continued problematic action by declaiming their thesis is binded to the antithesis of said contention, which makes any movement out of the situation impossible. If one already believes that they have the answer, how can any transition away from the problem occur? It cannot, and so it will not. Besides, what is an answer except the other side of the problematic equation? When there is a seeking of answers, there must in tandem be a seeking of problems, and in this search both are obviously found together, which leads to ever-increasing conflict. Within this conflict there is no freedom. Every problem must carry its solution, and every solution its problem. The cycle must always complete itself. In other words, a food problem will always equate to more food problems, and relationship issues to more relationship issues. When there are no descriptors, there can be no contemplation about whether the words in these equations are good or bad. It is subjectively up to each of us to potentially put forth a judgment upon the external by allowing it to dominate the senses and perceptions first, and then making a decisive conclusion about our action after the fact. Through this allowance, life happens to us, and we do not happen to life. By inverting the process, it can be seen what was previously occurring with an externally dominated capacity that blinds the internal processes, convincing the true disciple that they were always wrong and needed to continuously be thwarted by outside circumstances. The external therefore ended up dominating the life force and draining it of vital energy and capacity, while the internal was not cognized and therefore was inherently ignored. The problem-solution paradigm thus continued unabated. By flowing from the inner self to the external, there is a transposition that takes place which ends the need to consume problems and therefore seek solutions to those same problems. Food can be seen for what it is, a device within this construct that is utilized to carry energy forward. The relationship can heal because one is healing themselves, which will inevitably transgress outwards. If the other does not do the same, there may be a need to move on, since health does not attach itself to sickness. In either case, there is not a need or desire to cover the problem with another aspect of the same problem. Food is not sought after through guilt or complexity, and another relationship is not needed for one to feel complete and content. The inner living finds a balance of its own accord, and then there is truly a harmonization of the polarities, which is neutrality. Then one can begin the art of discipline.
Logian 5, Jesus said, "Recognize what is in your sight, and that which is hidden from you will become plain to you. For there is nothing hidden which will not become manifest." Interpretation, that which is in your sight, is sight itself, the observer that is you. If you recognize this, yourself will become plain to you. In truth you cannot hide from yourself, you can only choose to ignore the true nature, of what you refer to, when you use the word, I. It is as if the self hides from itself, in plain view of itself. That which is most obvious, usually receives the least amount of attention, and through ignorance comes forgetfulness. It is the self that is taken for granted, as its relevance is ignored. There is a difference between knowing, and realizing the importance of what it is that you know. A person may say, I know I am a spiritual being, but when the full realization of what they profess to know is revealed to them, it is like an earthquake that has shaken the soul, and caused a paradigm shift in consciousness, a rebirth. The self is incredibly obvious, but people are led to only focus on, and recognize things that are outside of the self, that is the mind, and the material things of the world. That which is hidden from you is yourself, and the only way to find yourself is to ignore the world and its endless cry for your attention. Look.
Now, are we one with Him who is our source? What time but now can truth be recognized? The present is the only time there is. And so today, this instant now, we come to look upon what is forever there. Not in our sight, but in the eyes of Christ. He looks past time and sees eternity as represented there. He hears the sounds the senseless, busy world engender, yet he hears them faintly. For beyond them all, he hears the song of heaven and the voice of God more clear, more meaningful, more near. The world fades easily away before his sight. Its sound grows dim. A melody from far beyond the world increasingly is more and more distinct. An ancient call to which he gives an ancient answer. You will recognize them both, for they are but your answer to your Father's call to you. Christ answers for you, echoing yourself, using your voice to give his glad consent, accepting your deliverance for you. How holy is your practicing today, as Christ gives you his sight and hears for you, and answers in your name the call he hears? How quiet is the time you give to spend with him beyond the world? How easily are all your seeming sins forgot and all your sorrows unremembered? On this day is grief laid by. For sights and sounds that come from nearer than the world are clear to you, who will today accept the gifts he gives. There is a silence into which the world cannot intrude. There is an ancient peace you carry in your heart and have not lost. There is a sense of holiness in you the thought of sin has never touched. All this today you will remember. Faithfulness in practicing today will bring rewards so great and so completely different from all things you sought before that you will know that here your treasure is and here your rest. This is the day when vain imaginings part like a curtain to reveal what lies beyond them. Now is what really they're made visible, while all the shadows which appear to hide it merely sink away. Now is the balance righted, and the scale of judgment left to him who judges true. And in his judgment will a world unfold in perfect innocence before your eyes. Now will you see it with the eyes of Christ. Now is its transformation clear to you. Brother, this day is sacred to your world. Your vision, given you from far beyond all things within the world, looks back on them in a new light. And what you see becomes the healing and salvation of the world. The valuable and valueless are both perceived and recognized for what they are. And what is worthy of you love receives your love, while nothing to be feared remains. We will not judge today. We will receive but what is given us from judgment made beyond the world. Our practicing today becomes our gift of thankfulness for our release from blindness and from misery. All that we see will but increase our joy because its holiness reflects our own. We stand forgiven in the sight of Christ, with all the world forgiven in our own. We bless the world as we behold it in the light in which our Savior looks on us and offer it the freedom given us through his forgiving vision, not our own. Open the curtain in your practicing by merely letting go all things you think you want. Your trifling treasures put away, and leave a clean and open space in your mind where Christ can come and offer you the treasure of salvation. He has need of your most holy mind to save the world. Is not this purpose worthy to be yours? Is not Christ's vision worthy to be sought above the world's unsatisfying goals? Let not today slip by without the gifts it holds for your receiving, your consent, and your acceptance. We can change the world if you acknowledge them. You may not see the value your acceptance gives the world, but this you surely want. You can exchange all suffering for joy this very day. Practice in earnest, and the gift is yours. Would God deceive you? Can His promise fail? Can you withhold so little when His hand holds out complete salvation to His Son? End of lesson.
Logian 22, Jesus saw infants being suckled. He said to His disciples, "These infants being suckled are like those who enter the kingdom." They said to Him, "Shall we then, as children, enter the kingdom?" Jesus said to them, "When you make the two one, and when you make the inside like the outside and the outside like the inside, and the above like the below, and when you make the male and the female one and the same, so that the male not be male nor the female female, and when you fashion eyes in the place of an eye, and a hand in place of a hand, and a foot in place of a foot, and a likeness in place of a likeness, then will you enter the kingdom?" Interpretation of, when you make the two one. When you make the divided mind, which is two, into an undivided mind, which is one. Interpretation of, when you make the inside like the outside and the outside like the inside, and the above like the below. The state of the self is dependent on the state of the mind. Likewise, the state of the mind is dependent on the state of the self. When the two are in conflict, peace is lost. If the mind is full of truth, and the self accepts that truth, then the self will be at peace, and the self which is above will be like the mind, which is below. This is why Jesus said, "I am the truth." Only the acceptance of truth will end the conflict between the self's desires and worldly temptations in the mind. When you realize that you don't need the things of the world, then its temptations will be silenced, as will the desire for them. Interpretation of, when you make the male and the female one and the same, so that the male not be male nor the female female. When you realize that a spiritual being has no gender and therefore you are not a physical being. Interpretation of, and when you fashion eyes in the place of an eye. When you learn to see with your spiritual eyes, that is have spiritual sight. Interpretation of, and a hand in place of a hand. This means your true selves will, in place of your false selves will. Interpretation of, and a foot in place of a foot. This means your spiritual journey in place of your physical one. Interpretation of, and a likeness in place of a likeness. This means God's image in place of the physical body's image, because we are made in God's image and not the image of a physical creature. Interpretation of, then will you enter the kingdom. Then your mind will become as the kingdom of heaven. You must come to know yourself.
It is the evening of the day. I sit and watch the children play. Smiling faces I can see, but not for me. I sit and watch as tears go by. My riches can't buy everything. I want to hear the children sing. All I hear is the sound of rain falling on the ground. I sit and watch as tears go by. the evening of the day. I sit and watch the children play, doing things I used to do. They think I'm new. I sit and watch as tears go by.
Logian 58, Jesus said, "Blessed is the man who has suffered and found life." Interpretation, blessed is the one who has suffered in a divided mind and has found their true self, for they have found life.
You won't surrender, which means, surrender means only accept this moment as it is. But you won't be able to surrender unless you're completely fed up with suffering. You've had enough suffering. And at some level, you recognize that most of your suffering is self-created. It is created out of resistance to what is. It is created out of an interpretation of something that is. It comes from a thought, from an interpretation, not from the situation. So you realize really that I've had enough suffering, and only when you've truly had enough suffering in your life are you able to say, I don't need it anymore. Suffering is a wonderful teacher. Suffering is most people's only spiritual teacher. And suffering deepens you. It gradually erodes the mind-made sense of self, the ego. And for some people, the point arrives where they realize, I have suffered enough. And that, for example, is the case with almost all the people who come to a retreat. If you ask them, they've all had their share of human suffering. Otherwise, they wouldn't be open to the message. They've had their share of human suffering, and they've reached a point where they are ready to listen to the message that says there is another way to live. There is another way in which you can live that does not create further suffering for yourself. Because to a large extent, humans create their own suffering. And so when you are ready to hear that message, and that's really the message that is in every religion. That's the message, the central message of Buddhism is the end of suffering. And even the central message of the teaching of Jesus is finding the pearl of great price, finding the kingdom of heaven that is within you here and now, as Jesus says. And that, of course, is the end of living in a state of suffering. So one could say that you need suffering for you to realize, for you to come to a point of realization that you do not need to suffer anymore. There's a paradox here. If I had not suffered, this teaching would not exist. So you could say it has come partly as a result of intense suffering, because as a human being, I would not have evolved spiritually if I had not suffered. So suffering was my main teacher, and suffering is for many people their main teacher. But then when they are ready, they come into contact with a spiritual teaching or teacher, and that can speed up the process of realization that you don't need to suffer anymore. You're ready to hear that. So the Buddha talked about nothing else already 2,600 years ago, that there can be an end to self-inflicted suffering. And when you don't inflict suffering on yourself anymore, and remember, it's the thoughts. Your thoughts make you suffer more than anything else. It's not usually the situation, it's your interpretation of the situation, of how dreadful it all is. And so when you see that, then you see there is another way to live in which I no longer mentally argue with what is. And that's the end of self-inflicted suffering. And if I no longer inflict suffering on myself, I no longer inflict suffering on others, because the two go together.
Those are days.